Hello guys, I did not have a chance to stream this particular game before the weekend, Wednesday night, because I was very unlucky, as you can see in this thing there. I have a rather nasty injury to my, I have a rather nasty injury to my middle finger. I was cleaning the lawnmower, and unfortunately the blade in the lawnmower had become extremely sharp due to small stones and stuff that are lying around in the backyard, and it's extremely difficult to get rid of all of them. And I was just, like I said, cleaning the wet grass from inside, because even though it had been dry for a couple of days and a lot of sunshine, there was still a lot of moisture in the grass, so it just packed itself a lot. So I just had to let it blow out of the sides, and every time I had to use my hands to clean anything out, I was forced to stop the motor, of course. And then roll with the changes, as we can say. And then, of course, when I was cleaning it out, I just missed an extra sharp bit, and I sliced a little bit from the top of my finger. Let's see. I'm going to go to my Facebook page here. I want to just show the original picture I took of it. Let me see. Extremely pretty, as you are about to see, if I can find the notifications to my... Okay, so there we have it. What I have there on my, on the tip of my finger, is a silicone patch, just to limit the danger of having a pad just dry up on the inside there and just sit forever, because as soon as that would pry it loose, it would be extremely painful, and it would probably start just rip up the sores and start the bleeding again. So enough of that. The game I played on Wednesday night, after I finally got home, I had to start my game on my phone. I had basically thought that if my opponent was going to play 1d4 and follow that up with 2c4, I was going to try going for the Grünfeld. I am not very versed in using a Grünfeld, but somehow I like the complications that come out of it. And as I have been known to do myself in complicated positions, I have had all kinds of trouble in my games, can we say? Yeah, okay. So my opponent was Felipekaox from Brazil, and he was very nice about the moving of the playing time, because I had some unforeseen problems I needed to be taken care of, and to him I can only say thank you very much, man. It was it helped a lot, and we can just start the game then. And if he had played e4 on his first move, I was going to play the Scandi, as I usually do against e4. That's just my go-to response. All kinds of results, but that's just how things are. And he started with d4. I played knight f6, c4, g6, bishop f4, and this is a move I have never seen in the Grunfeld. I'm not sure if he was what he was planning there, but I decided to just go with the next move, which is going to be the transposition into the Grunfeld with d5, and he played knight c6, and by transposition we are into the Grunfeld defense, the Brinkmann attack. This is a line I am absolutely not familiar with. I have only seen a few opening moves, and from that point on I was completely in deep water and barely knew how to swim. So all I could really think about was just trying to play some principled moves, and when we check the engine later, you are going to see that some of my moves were absolutely not optimal. So bishop g7, knight f3, queen d2. I understand that this is has transposed now into the three knights variation Hungarian attack. And like before, another line that I'm not familiar with. Most of the time, as I understand it, white takes on d5, I take back with a knight, then he maybe plays e6 or even e4 to kick my knight, and then I take on c3, and he would, so as we could see, if he should take like this, I take with a knight, he plays e4, I take, he takes, and then I would follow it up with c5. But our game just took a little bit different route. Here I played c6. I just wanted to make sure that I had some support for my d5 pawn in case things started to heat up here. So and here is my daughter popping in to say hi to dad. The engine does not like this c6 move, so let's just continue. This is the move I expected, the bishop h6, knight g4. Then engine does not like this move either, but I decided, okay, I just want to make sure that he gets rid of his bishop there one way or the other. So he took on g7, I responded in kind, h3, and I moved my knight back. And around this time, well, there's not much to say about the position. It's pretty even, nothing particular going on. So we exchange on d5, he plays e4 finally, then I take on c3, he takes with his b-pawn, and I'm told that this is a bad move. I should have played c5 this in this position, because it would just open up lines for my rooks.
Farðu nú að fá þér eitthvað að borða, skömmi. Það til jógurt í ískápnum, vaniljógurt.
So, bishop c4. Bishop b7. I just wanted to increase the pressure on e4. Castle short, knight d7, rook c1, rook a to c1, I mean, knight f6, rook f to e1. So far, I've been playing a few moves that the computer doesn't really approve of. But from my point of view, those were all natural moves. Like I said, I'm not very versed in the theory, so you have to bear that in mind when you take a look at this. Bishop b3, rook a to d8. I just wanted to put my rook on a square opposing my opponent's queen. Knight to g5. And I saw if I would push, he would absolutely take with his bishop here. And I wasn't very interested in that because I didn't want to take back here and see the royal fork here on the king, both rooks and queen. The whole family fork thing, I'm not interested in something like that, so I decided just to leave it as is and played h6. My opponent decided it would be wise to just back off with his knight. I played knight to h7. The computer did not like this move, but my thought was I had put my ideas behind. I was going to play f5 and then follow up with g5 and g4. But before I could get anything done in that direction, my opponent he miscalculated the position and blundered awfully. He played knight to e5. And if you have been playing for a while, the next move is so obvious. It's an easy tactic. Take the knight on e5, and he can't take back because then his queen is gone. And the positive thing is, if I take his queen there, I can retake this. I take back. I don't know what he would make, what kind of move he would make. Probably try to oppose, but I would just double up, and that would probably end up in all of the rooks being exchanged off the board. But he found an interesting response. He took on h6, and I had no choice. I had to take because otherwise my queen would be off the board as well. So I take, he takes back on e5, e6. This is a move I should not have made. I should have just blasted my rook all the way up to e2, up to d2, I mean. And if he comes here, I would just take, plain and simple. The main problem with, or even I would have the option of moving my rook here, because if he would take here, then so we just go back one move here. If I play here, he plays here, and I play here. If he doesn't start exchanging, then I'm going to win a rook, especially if he would be greedy enough to take here. But he could have it as an intermezzo, really, because if I take, now if, let's see, I move here, he comes here, I double up. He could take, I take back, and then he takes here. Then, of course, I would have c5. I'll attack this pawn. And yeah, he would probably play his f3 pawn, but regardless of that, he would have a tough position, because this pawn is in a tough spot, and I would be moving my knight here to f8 or g5 and try to find a spot to snipe at his e5 pawn. But yeah, e6, I just didn't want to deal with all those complications, so I decided to lock up the position. c5, this was done to open up my bishop. He plays rook to d6, I take, he takes back with a pawn, rook d8, e5, he didn't want me to take this pawn, of course, that would be bad for him. So I decided to place my knight there on f8, just lock up the position. f4, and now I started shuffling my pieces around, because I was planning on advancing my queenside majority. Rook e3, king g7, a4, knight to d7. This is where the shuffling starts well and proper. a6. I think the computer was in doubt about this move, but my thought was after I have moved my knight to b8 and my bishop to d7, I would have this break. And but he started moving his pawns over. I decided to move over here, just as a prophylactic move. He, of course, did not want me to take. Knight b8, my plan is in full flight there. Bishop d7, now I have swapped position with my pieces. Of course, he did not want me to take a4 for free. So I played knight to c6. I think greed got the better of him there. So he played this bishop again to c4. So I moved my rook over across the bottom of my files. And he played g4. I think this is a rather weak move. I could have won a pawn very easily, but I decided to keep up with my queenside plan. Knight to c6, just kick his bishop away again and win that pawn. I decided there was no reason to take when he pushed his f-pawn. So he decided to push further, and this, I think, is a massive blunder. He is more or less locking up his only avenue of counterplay. So, and I have a piece for a pawn, and his position, I have won it back there, so I'm a full piece up. So I just moved my king out of the way. He plays g5. So I start moving my pieces around again. And this is a big mistake he made there. There was no reason to move this rook over. He should have just moved his king to g3 and maybe g4 afterwards, and just try to keep his position solid. But unfortunately for him, he just decided upon the wrong plan. So I just moved my rook back. There was no reason to keep him in the corner anymore. If he brings his bishop back to c4, then I have b5, kicking him out of the way again, and then c4, And then I just can just start pushing my pawns here. Now I have 3-on-1 majority here on the queen side. And it's very easy to make a passed pawn in this position. So he pushes. And to take, I could have done that. I could have taken, he takes back with a rook. And then I move my king out of the way. And he is forced into a rook trade. And he is just dead lost. Because his pawns aren't going anywhere. If he would move his bishop here, after we have traded the rooks, then yeah, he would. I would not need to do anything here. He would have to take from here to here. My king would take back. He would move here to prepare pushing his g pawn. I would just move my king back here, so he could do whatever he wanted. But I would not be moving my my king anywhere. He would just be sitting there, keeping tabs on this. If he would trade, I would just take back, and no matter what he would do, he would have no access to my eighth rank with his king to kick my king out of the way or anything like that. So I wasn't worried, and my pawns would just be storming the queen side. So he takes, and that was a mistake. There he, I think the machine is regarding this as a plus 8 for black. So unfortunately for him, it was just not a good place to be. So I just took, nothing else to do. He takes with the king, I take the pawn. So this is pretty self-explanatory. In this position, he has no access to my pawns. My king just locks up his pawns. And now I can just start just removing his pawns. Everything going very smoothly. And in this position, he resigned. Absolutely nothing to do, really, because he has no place to go, really. I mean, bishop a6 is just a nothing move. If I had the interest, I could just start moving my king towards his bishop to claim it. And yeah, he might have king to e5, but my response would be just the very simple knight to f5 or knight to c4. And he wouldn't have any access to my pawns. And yeah, my a pawn is completely unstoppable. He would probably have to try something like this. But this pawn would be gone very shortly. And I have my bishop ready to just go after his. So let's take a look with the engine afterwards. This was basically my... I was quite happy with most of my play. I don't think I made any massive blunders. The computer gives me a question mark with one or two moves, I think. So... pretty normal stuff. And the computer does not like this move of his, claims it to be an inaccurate move, and I pay back in kind. both of those moves were basically unusable. I should have just played straight to c5. Just heap the pressure on the center. That's because in the Grünfeld, white wants the center, and black usually tries to snipe at it with any means necessary. So again, the computer does not like this move any more than it likes mine here, because this is supposedly a very bad move. But the thing is, if he would move back here, then I'm suddenly in a much better position because I could just kick this guy. So let's take a look at that. If I play like this, this is his only place to go. And then I have two decent options. I could just get rid of this pawn, which would of course follow e4. And then I have the option of either e4 or g4. Or maybe even b5 if I wanted to be greedy and hold on to the pawn. But he takes, I take back, and then he played h3, knight f6, so the position is pretty pretty stable. He takes, I take with a knight, which the computer does not like. E4, I take on c3. And b6 is, I thought that was a necessary move because I wanted to fianchetto my bishop, and maybe in some lines, move my bishop to a6, because then if he takes, then I could take with my knight and then put it back on c7 to keep control of the light squares around this area. Bishop c4, bishop b7. I probably should have played bishop a6 there. Just kick this guy away or force him into a trade so he could castle. And at this point he has a slight advantage. Nothing much. But yeah, he is he has a better position there. Everything is more loose, and right there I should have played h6. I think that would have been a much better move than what I did. Yeah, the machine doesn't really give much out of it, but yeah, he could then drop this pawn and it could go into similar lines as what happened in the actual game. Though he would not be blundering his knight. So, but I played rook a to d8. The computer is not very happy with that move, claims it's an inaccurate move. So he comes to g5. I kick him right away. Knight to h7. And then comes the blunder. He jumps from a plus 1.9 to a minus 4 with his one move. So, only thing to do, just take. I had to debate with myself for a while there. Because this was... I thought, does he have a trap in line for me here? Is there something nasty waiting to be unleashed? But fortunately for me, he did not have anything at the time. There was nothing in the position. So he took, I took, he takes. And there, the computer did not like what I did. Yeah, knight g5 would have been a stronger move. Just stopping any rook d8, no, rook d1 shenanigans, at least from this one. Pressuring here, and so I could follow up with knight to e6 and just locking up completely, and he would have no place to go. But rook c to d1, c5, pretty self-explanatory, really. In this position, I was in a bit of a bind. I wasn't quite sure what to do. The computer would like me to play g5, but for me at the time, I did look at this line, but I just didn't see anything so concretely strong about it. I didn't see a follow-up. But maybe playing this move and then maybe moving the king over to push this pawn might have been a stronger way of playing. But yeah, I just didn't fancy those lines. I didn't see anything to follow it up. So I just decided to go for the queen side and just take my time, because it has been my folly in many games to make hasty decisions, and those eventually cost me the games. I have a few videos showing exactly that. In a little bit too much of a hurry, and then I had to pay the price. There was another game I played yesterday morning, which was exactly like that. I had just won the exchange from my opponent, and a couple of moves later, I just blundered my queen without any compensation. So I was just not looking at the position. I just played without thinking, and my opponent just destroyed any any chance I had of coming back into the game. He was very quick and deserved this win thoroughly. So f4 he plays, bishop c8. The computer again doesn't understand the plan behind this, and that's what my chess coach has been telling me. If you have a plan, even if it's a bad plan and you just don't know it, you should try to follow through with it, because along the path of seeing this plan come to fruition, your opponent might make mistakes. So don't stress, and the further Stockfish looks into this position, the better it is. When it first looked at the position, I was set down to like 2.1, but in this position I'm almost back up to 3, so it sees maybe a little bit more. The computer does not like this move of his, because it limits the lateral movement of his rook, especially with this pawn here on c3. He has a pawn on h3. The computer wants me to play g5 here, but for me, I don't see the point. It's a nothing move for me. I have absolutely no idea what to do to follow through with it. It would just opening up a path for his rook to my king. He suddenly has a passed pawn on the h-file, and for my taste, that's a big no-no, especially because I'm about to play on the queen side. So no chance in hell. So I just decided to tuck my queen into safety. Now my king, pardon me, bishop to c4, knight to d7, a4. I don't really understand why he played that move. He was probably trying just to grab some space on the queen side and limit my play, but this only served to strengthen my resolve of playing on the queen side, because now I could set up this pawn as a target. So e6, a6, I mean. This was just to make sure that if he ever played a5, I would have this. So his a pawn would be stuck forever, because it's so easy to just lock it up, just bishop to ASICs, and then just go around very leisurely with my knight and just pick up this pawn, and he would have no chance of keeping hold of it. So h4, not a very good move on his part, but I think he just felt the heat. He didn't have much to work with, and he probably wanted to open up the h-file for his rook, but on his next move he just closed up shop again. So I decided to press. He comes back with his other pawn and just closes any chance of me taking this pawn, but I never meant to take that pawn anyway. Yeah, my stepson's dog was just singing a bit out in the hall. Knight b8. Initially, Stockfish did not like this move, but the further it looks into it, the more it makes sense. Especially because I'm just shuffling my pieces and getting them into good attacking positions. King h2, not the best move in the position. He had better options, but he just didn't find them, fortunately for me. Bishop to d7, just pressuring this this a pawn. If he would push here now, I would not take. Absolutely not. I would push b5 to kick his bishop away, and then after he moves his bishop there, I would just come here, and this pawn is a goner. So I would just keep the cohesion of my position going, because he has nothing to do. He could try pushing this pawn, but I would just push here. And this pawn would still be dead. He has no access to it. Of course, yeah, he could play this. I have this. Yeah, of course, yeah. This would be a bad mistake. Yeah. Yeah, probably pushing the pawn would be a better move. Or just moving my rook over. But yeah, knight c6. The computer likes bishop d1 for him, but or rook d2, or e2, I mean. But yeah, he found none of those moves. Bishop c4. To keep those variations in there. The computer wanted me to just support with the knight, but I did not want to repeat. For me, it made a lot more sense just to move my rook over. Just keep the shape of my pawn structure on the queen side healthy. G4 for him. I'm not really sure what he thought he could accomplish with this move. If he pushes his h pawn, he takes back, and I move my king to h6. And that, by that, I just blockade, and he has no access to my king with his rook, because my pawn on f7 guards the g6 square, and his bishop has no access either, and his king would not be getting into this either, because my king is taking care of the necessary squares around it. So I just decided to get rid of his bishop from this, and he takes the wrong route. He was probably of the mind that he needed to both guard the c4 square and to oppose my queenside pawn storm, because he saw what was coming. Of course, I could have moved my rook over and just switched my focus to the king side, but I was just so set on following through with my plan. So there was no chance I was going to change plans halfway through. I saw it was a winning plan, and I was just going to ignore anything else. So I take. So he pushes his f-pawn, and just a poor move, really. So I just moved my bishop back, and as usual, Stockfish is not very happy with my choices. For whatever reason, I have no idea. But the further it looks into it, the more it comes to accept it. So when it goes to, from -4.1 to -3.7, not such a bad trade-off. So he pushes his f-pawn, and that's only good for me. So king h7, and he pushes his g-pawn, which is probably not the best way to go about things. He should have left it there and just brought his king up in support. So knight to c6 again. Stockfish does not understand the reasoning behind this. Rook h3. Of course, I could take this pawn now, but I didn't think there was any hurry. I would take it eventually. And my reasoning is that I can always take and check him here, or if he moves his bishop out of the out of this diagonal, I can take my sweet time in picking off this pawn. So I decided to move my rook over. He pushes h5, and as you can see on the arrows, the computer likes this the best. Then he would have check. I could go here, and then he would have to move his rook out of the way. But I decided it would be more prudent to wait. So I just moved my king out of the way right away. And as usual, Stockfish wasn't very keen on this move at first. But my thought process was like this. If he pushes, again, my plan was just king h7, and that means I have blockaded this his pawn here. I have blockaded this pawn here. He has no entrance into my position anywhere. He might want to maybe sacrifice a bishop on g6, but since I have my rook here on the back rank, he has no way of just getting into any attacking position. So he decided to take on g6, which was a very poor move. He basically gives up the rest of what he had as a counterplay, because in this position I just swap rooks and then take this pawn, He tries some desperate attempts at going after my pawns, but now his e5 pawn is dead, and he has no chance of breaking through anywhere. So he tries to pressure my knight. I take this pawn. He was of course trying to get to the back, trying to pick up my a6 pawn, but of course it was just a simple push away from safety. King g3, knight to c4, just making sure that I just pick up anything loose. And in this position my opponent resigned, and there is really not much he can do. I mean, he could move his bishop to e4 or whatever, but my thought was I would just push in this position. I would just push after he makes a move like this, and he might need to go here, and I would just push further. And as soon as he would do that, I would have my knight, my bishop coming through here, just putting pressure everywhere. So he had no option. He just had to resign there because he had no moves left. So this was my game against Felipekaox. Again, I would like to thank him for his extreme sportsmanship of delaying the game 2 hours for me when I was forced to go to the doctor's office. And it was a very tough decision to ask for, but fortunately for me, he was great about the whole thing. And yeah, thank you, Felipe. You fought well. I had to really work at proving that the advantage I got after you blundered your piece. Fortunately for me, I managed to stay patient enough, which has been my big problem throughout my chess career forever. So again, thank you, and for anybody who was watching, thank you for tuning in, and goodbye for now. I might be streaming a bit later today, but tonight I have a lesson with international master John Bartholomew. He is the man who is responsible for me being able to show more patience and restraint in my matches, not going just all out crazy in my games. It's so incredibly easy to just blow a good position by being impatient. So fortunately for me, he has been able to instill some sense of, I don't know what to call it, maturity or anything along those lines. So again, thank you for tuning in, and goodbye for now.